If you're an individual and you've got two or three different pension pots, you've got bits of savings here, there, or wherever, and actually your lifestyle choice is, well, look, you know, I don't want to, you know, I've been working, you know, 8 hours a day for the last 40 years. I don't want to go to nothing. I want to do something else. You know, there is much more of a lifestyle kind of decision here, which the financial piece is clearly a critical piece, but it needs to be understood in the round. And the thing that always worries me is that even if they go for the open market option, it's a decision made almost in isolation of all the other things that they may have around it,
which will drive time.
And I think
doesn't negate the importance of making a decision, the right decision, and making the most out of that.
The interesting thing I think is that we suggested that it was a red herring, the removal of the new compulsory annuitisation, and as pension professionals sat around the table, we're already defaulting back to annuity and the different vagaries of choosing the right annuity.
But annuity for many people is going to be the right option.
Absolutely.
It's guaranteed income for the rest of their life.
But it is interesting that, you know, we all still see a big future, and certainly choosing the right annuity is actually moving above the removal to need to do so. I think what the removal does is actually add a layer of complexity to an individual's circumstances which they don't possibly need.
And individuals, you know, may make other decisions. I mean, this goes back to the renewal of default retirement ages. You know, an individual might, you know, if they thought, well, actually, on the best annuity I can get, you know, the income I can get per month is, you know, £1,000 a month, and actually I don't think, you know, yeah, I want to, you know, I need to do better than that, then actually that might dictate to them, well, actually, do you know what, I'm going to carry on working for another 2 years, 3 years. You know, so I suppose some of the concerns that I have is that the people are not given that education it's all about, you know, your retirement and how you're going to provide an income, but don't read as anywhere you're going to get an income is pension. You know, it may be other things, and even when it is pension, it may not just be one pension, it may be multiple pensions. So it's how do you get that rounded conversation. So again, people are making some sort of informed choice about what they're doing, and they're doing it with their eyes open. They're not going, yeah, gone and got the annuity, and then 2 years down the road, you know, when they're talking to, you know, their mate down the pub, going, oh, actually, you know, if you'd waited until you were, you know, 5 years older, you know, you would have got a better rate, and, you know, and actually all they did was give up their job and go and get another job that would have paid them half the rate against inflation.
This is again going back to the point, if we make it easier for people to do the right things, they're more likely to do the right things. Martin's story about how when he was at the NHS, you were automatically included in the pension scheme. You had no choice. In 1986,
which was automatically indexed.
Before 1986, if your employer had a final salary scheme, and if they were minded to do so, they could compel you to join. That's the golden generation of pensioners who are now retiring.
Yep.
When the moment they took that away, it's gone downhill.
Of course, we're talking about a related point here, on actually related to DB here, is that, you know, I know DWP and TPR are now starting to look at companies who are choosing to offer exchanges in return for a freeze on future pension increases at retirement. And do people really understand what they might be giving up in terms of a short-term cash incentive? I think the same is true of education for annuity advice, particularly in an economic situation where we don't know what's going to happen with inflation. And if it goes up...
I don't think we should be naive enough to assume that people don't sometimes understand their circumstances. You know, there may be people where a flat annuity is absolutely the right thing. There may be people who buying an immediate annuity may be absolutely the right thing. There may be people who making no pension savings might be absolutely the right thing. So rather than having a system of automatic defaults that just says, well, this is the right way to do, you will do that, this is why I think good governance is important, because it can be much more sensitive to the individual circumstances. We're here to try and do the right things for you. But, you know, if this isn't the right thing for you, well, you've got an alternative.
I can well believe there are a small proportion of people for whom a flat annuity is right. I don't believe it's 95%.
No, I don't think
it is. I think it's more likely to be 5%.
I agree. I think it could be a very small proportion of people. But if you shoehorn them into a system that fits 100%, then they're stuffed.